This is an 1806 Grasshopper engine. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Now, we don't know a lot about this engine, and we'll come to exactly why that is in a bit. But for now, let's start off by talking about what a grasshopper is and why they were made. So unlike a normal beam engine, which typical steam engines were at that time, grasshoppers only had sort of part of a fulcrum. This large beam at the top here is actually very small and very light compared to what most steam engines would have had at the time. And the fulcrum is actually right here, normally sitting on massive piers of brick or stone. Got two little pipes with a couple cross pieces to hold them in place. And in fact, you can see it's even pivoted. This fulcrum moves. So why does that happen? So typical of grasshoppers, well, all steam engines really, your piston has a piston rod coming out of it which must go straight up and straight down, and that connects to the main overhead beam. The beam in a typical steam engine, a typical beam engine, goes to a fixed point on the fulcrum and rotates across the fulcrum. In this case, this fulcrum will actually go back and forth rotating here, as well as allowing it to twist. Partway back, you have a feed water pump. And you see you do have a bit of a parallel motion connected to the top of the feed water pump. But your main connection, what you actually have this engine here for, so those large silver rods in the middle. So you're connected just behind the center, and that goes up and then down to a large crank. It goes up to give you a little more length. Then on the large crank, that actually rotates that center shaft, which turns the flywheel. And beyond the flywheel, you have this connecting rod coming out. And you could have connected that to overhead line drive system, to a geared system, whatever you wanted to connect to. Flywheel should be very well balanced. And with this keyed system on the end here, you could secure just about anything you needed and provide typically a reasonable amount of power. Well, it's buried fairly deep inside here. This does have the standard features of a standard steam engine. It has a cylinder. The cylinder is a 17-inch diameter, 38.5-inch stroke. It produced 25 horsepower at 60 RPM, it's estimated. You have boiler feed pumps, large flywheel, which you have if you're going into rotary motion as opposed to just reciprocating motion, like earlier steam engines. In this case, a large six-spoke flywheel, very heavy, help to maintain even speed. The grasshoppers were favored for their smaller size. These can run about half the size of a comparable standard beam engine. It cost considerably less. The top beam had a whole lot less stress on it, and therefore it could be made much lighter, much less expensive. Despite that, this beam does show signs that at one point it actually did break and was repaired. So despite Henry Ford's buyer saying this is one of the finest examples of a grasshopper engine still in existence, it was purchased in 1929, they didn't really know very much about it. And the reason is where they got it. This was picked up from a barge from the Great Eastern Railway Company. And it showed, when they got it back here to the museum, showed signs of massive saltwater corrosion damage from having been submerged for a long period of time. So did a ship carrying it sink? Was it being used on a ship? We don't know. What we do know is it came from Lauvstadt Harbor at the far eastern tip of England. And pretty likely that that dredge actually pulled it up and sold it to the Henry Ford Museum. The internal workings are completely seized up. There's no moving it at this point. All the wooden parts had to be replaced. They had rotted out so badly. But still, this is a great example of how these engines worked. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution.
Before you go, I do need your help. There's two things you can do. Number one is help YouTube get more people to the channel. Easiest way you can do that, completely free, hit like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and best of all, if you can comment more than just two or three words. That tells YouTube, you know, this video is good, the channel's good, send more people here. Second thing you can do, each of these videos ends up being pretty expensive to actually produce. Obviously it's hours of work for each one, but I also have to actually drive to the locations. And if it's far enough away, I have to spend a night in order to do all the on-location filming that I do for these videos, that I think is essential for the videos. If you can help out financially, either with a super thanks, or if you can help out over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution, that'll help me to extend my range even further, get out to more and better sites, and bring you even better videos. Thanks for watching. Look forward to seeing you next time.